Elizabeth Bishop was considered an inspirational poet of the 20th century. Throughout her life, she considered herself a strong feminist, but wanted her works never to be based on her gender or sexual orientation.
In Worcester, Massachusetts, Elizabeth Bishop entered the world on February 8, 1911.
Shortly after her birth, her father passed away, leading to her mother's insanity. Her mother was admitted to an asylum in 1916 and later died there in 1934. Elizabeth and her mother never reconnected before her death.
During her early years, she moved between many family members.
From age 3 to 6, she lived with her grandparents in Great Village, Nova Scotia, a period she referenced many times in her writing.
This was where she learned to be a great fisherwoman.
In 1929, Bishop started college, studying to become a composer. She later switched to English due to her overwhelming stage fright.
Letter to New York.
In your next letter, I wish you'd say where you are going and what you are doing. How are the plays, and after the plays, what other pleasures are you pursuing? Taking cabs in the middle of the night, driving as if to save your soul, where the road goes round and round the park, and the meter glares like a mural owl. And the trees look so queer and green, standing alone in big black caves, and suddenly you're in a different place where everything seems to happen in waves. And coming out of the brownstone house to the gray sidewalk, the watered street, one side of the building rises with the sun, like glistening field of wheat. Wheat, not oats, dear. I'm afraid if it's wheat, it's none of your sowing. Nevertheless, I'd like to know what you are doing and where you are going.
In 1934, the year of her mother's death, Bishop met Marianne Moore. Moore took a keen interest in Bishop's writing and convinced the poet not to attend Cornell Medical School and to continue pursuing a writing career.
In 1945, Bishop won the Hampton Peninsula Poetry Prize Fellowship Award. This was the first award she received for her work. This preceded the publishing of her first collection, North and South, in 1946. This collection included the poem, The Fish.
The fish. I caught a tremendous fish and held him beside the boat half out of water, with my hook fast in a corner of his mouth. He didn't fight. He hadn't fought at all. He hung a grunting weight, battered and venerable and homely. Here and there his brown skin hung in strips like ancient wallpaper, and its pattern of darker brown was like wallpaper, shapes like full-blown roses, stained and lost through age. He was speckled with barnacles, fine rosettes of lime, and infested with tiny white sea lice, and underneath two or three rags of green weed hung down. While his gills were breathing in the terrible oxygen, the frightening gills, fresh and crisp with blood that can cut so badly, I thought of the coarse white flesh packed in like feathers, the big bones and the little bones, the dramatic reds and blacks of his shiny entrails, and the pink swim bladder, like a big peony. I looked into his eyes, which were far larger than mine, but shallower and yellowed, the irises backed and packed with tarnished tin foil, seen through lenses of old scratched isinglass. They shifted a little, but not to return my stare. It was more like the tipping of an object toward the light. I admired his sullen face, the mechanism of his jaw, and then I saw that from his lower lip, if you could call it a lip, grim, wet, and weapon-like, hung 5 old pieces of fish line, or 4 and a wire leader with the swivel still attached, with all their 5 big hooks grown firmly in his mouth. A green line frayed at the end where he broke it, 2 heavier lines, and a fine black thread still crimped from the strain and snap when it broke and he got away. Like medals with their ribbons frayed and wavering, the 5-haired beard of wisdom trailing from his aching jaw. I stared and stared, and victory filled up the little rented boat from the pool of bilge where oil had spread a rainbow around the rusted engine to the baler rusted orange, the sun-cracked thwarts, the oarlocks on their strings, the gunnels, until everything was rainbow, rainbow, rainbow. And I let the fish go.
In Bishop, narrative is typically forestalled by description. Thus is part of what turns her stories into poems and what makes them more spatial than linear. But it's also true that each description carries within the fragment of another story, so that diachronic sequence is converted into synchronic layering of narrative. The description, in other words, introduces a number of free motives that invite interpretive application into the primary associated motives, but that are not obviously connected. In a sense, the bladder of the fish, speckled with barnacles, fine rosettes of lime, and infested with tiny white sea lice, is a figure for the suspension out of linear logic, as are the strips of ancient wallpaper that embodies another unpursued narrative, one of the poet's memory stained and lost through age. Bishop's descriptions are full of lost or erased narratives.
Then, in 1947, she won the Guggenheim Fellowship Award.
She started to pick up a lot of literary attention and spirit of her life and was appointed consultant of poetry at the Library of Congress in 1949 and won the Pulitzer Prize for Poetry in 1947.
One, art. The art of losing isn't hard to master. So many things seem filled with the intent to be lost, that the loss is no disaster. Lose something every day, except the fluster of lost dorkies, the hour badly spent. The art of losing isn't hard to master. Then practice losing further, losing faster. Places and names and where it was you meant to travel. None of these will bring disaster. I lost my mother's watch, and look, my last or next to last of three loved houses went. The art of losing isn't hard to master. I lost two cities, lovely ones, and the vaster sub-realms I owned. Two rivers, a continent. I missed them, but it wasn't a disaster. Even losing you, the joking voice, a gesture I love, I shan't have lied. It's evident the art of losing's not too hard to master, though it may have looked like. Write it like disaster.
In 1947, she met Robert Lowell, a man who became a dear friend of hers. The pair communicated mostly through letters over the years. The death of her good friend, Robert Lowell, in 1977 inspired the poem North Haven, one of the last poems to be written by Bishop.
In the 1960s, she traveled to Brazil and Mexico multiple times.
She was influenced greatly by the diverse and layered culture the two countries offered.
During these years, she won three different awards.
In 1969, Bishop's partner, Loda Di Macedo, died from an overdose on tranquilizers. Her death led Bishop to move back to the United States, where she became very depressed and struggled with alcoholism. These battles continued throughout the rest of her life.
The death of her lover inspired the poem Insomnia. Insomnia by Elizabeth Bishop. The moon in the bureau mirror looks out a million miles, and perhaps with pride at herself that she never, never smiles. Far and away beyond sleep, or perhaps she's a daytime sleeper. By the universe deserted, she told it to go to hell, and she'd find a body of water or a mirror on which to dwell. So wrap up care in a cobweb and drop it down below. Into that world inverted, where left is always right, where the shadows are really the body, where we stay awake all night, where the heavens are shallow as the sea, is now deep and too lonely.
Despite all of her issues in her personal life, Bishop never wrote about her personal life in her poetry.
In 1972, Bishop stated, "One can use one's life as material for poems. One does anyway. But these letters, aren't you violating a trust? If you were given permission, if you hadn't changed them, etc. But art just isn't worth that much. In 1976, Bishop was the first American and first woman to be awarded the Neustadt International Prize and the Books Abroad Prize. During this time, she was also elected to the American Academy of Arts and Letters.
In her apartment in Boston on October 6, 1979, Bishop dies of a cerebral aneurysm, leaving behind works that continue to inspire and awe scholars and students to this day.
Uber!
Can you like say like 3, 2, 1 and then...
Are we ready?
Wait, not...
Okay.
Tell me if I
was. Okay.
Your face looks stupid. Just so you know.
I got sea fish!
Sea fish! Bless you. Julie, what's your favorite color?
Blue. Auction.
What?
The fish. I lost my mother's watch. Then, in 1947, she won the Guggenheim Fellowship Award.
Oh my gosh, I'm recording.
What did you do?
We're about to go undercover as a dinosaur.
Is there lipstick on my teeth?